When we derived the optical flow constraint equation, we made the assumption that the displacements delta x and delta y are really small. So what happens if you have large motion between consecutive images? So consider this case here. You have two images taken in quick succession. Let's assume that in this case the camera is moving, and that's the cause of the motion. And because the tree is close to the camera, its motion is going to be substantial as per perspective projection, maybe by tens of pixels. In this case, we can't assume that delta x, delta y are going to be small. That is, our Taylor series approximation for the image brightness, I, is no longer valid, which also means that our simple linear optical flow constraint equation is not valid anymore. So what do we do in this case? But there's a simple trick that we can play here, which is by using what's called a resolution pyramid. Let's say that these are the images that were given to us, taken at time t and t plus delta t, and let's say that the resolution of each image is n by n. What we are going to do is to compute lower resolution versions of these two images. We can compute images that are of resolution n by 2 times n by 2. Simple way to do this is that you take each 2 by 2 window in one of these images and then find the average of those values and use that value in this new low resolution image. So that's easy enough to do. But the main point to note here is that if the motion of a particular scene point in at this resolution was 100 pixels, it's going to be 50 pixels here. And you keep going. You can go to lower resolutions, n by 4 times n by 4, and maybe you come down to n by 8 times n by 8, so very small number of pixels. But at some point, all motions are going to be less than a pixel in magnitude. And if that is the case, now at that resolution, that very low resolution, your optical flow constraint equation becomes valid again. So that's the key observation. So here's the algorithm for then going from coarse to fine estimation of optical flow. You start with your lowest resolution, these tiny little images that you see right here. And we apply our optical flow algorithm, perhaps the Lucas-Conardi algorithm, and we get optical flow. We are now going to use this optical flow to warp the image in the next resolution, next higher resolution. So we can essentially take this optical flow and push the pixels around in this image to compute a new image, which is a warped version of it. Now, of course, if all of these estimates were precise and were computed at the highest resolution, this image would exactly equal to this. But of course, this is being computed at a lower resolution, so it's going to be imprecise. But anyway, this is going to be closer to this image at t plus delta t than the image taken at time t. And now what we're going to do is compute the optical flow between these two images. Remember that that is okay to do now, perhaps, because these two images have motions that are very small with respect to each other because we have taken care of most of the large motions by applying this warp right here. So you have this optical flow right here, which you're going to now add to the previous one. You can see this one is sort of the residual flow, if you will. You add those two together to get a new flow, which you're going to use to warp the next level of resolution. And you keep going till you finally arrive at the highest resolution images, and that gives you the final flow at every pixel in the image. This method works really well because you're propagating this information from lower resolutions to higher resolutions while always ensuring that the optical flow constraint equation remains valid. So let's take a look at how this works. Here's a scene. You can see that you have rich texture here, less texture here, large motions and small motions, but you get a fairly good optical flow result. Again, each vector here each needle that you see right here reveals the speed of the motion of the point as well as the direction. Here's another interesting example which has rotation in it. And you can see the optical flow vectors in this case, consistent with the motion. Here's another one. And again, there is sort of a rotation field right here. So it works pretty well. Now, I should mention for the sake of completeness that there is another approach, a more of a brute-forced approach that we can take to computing optical flow as well. And that's based on our good old idea of template matching. So let's say we're given this image, time t, t plus delta t right here. And let's say that we want to find optical flow corresponding to this small window right here. Well, we can use that window as a template and go and search for the best match in the other image by using a large enough window. We have to make the search window, the search space, large enough because we don't really know how strong the motion is, what the magnitude of motion is. And then we find the best match, and the difference between the locations of these two windows is the optical flow vector UV. Now, of course, the problem with this is that it can be very slow, especially if we're using fairly large search spaces right here. And it can be very slow because you've got to repeat this for every point, every pixel in the image. But also, we have to take into consideration the fact that you could end up with mismatches more likely here. You're not using local image derivatives anymore, and therefore you could go and latch on to this patch might indeed correspond to some other patch on the tree, which is quite far away and has nothing to do with optical flow at all. It just is that the appearances match. So there are major advantages of using local derivatives, as we did earlier, to compute optical flow.